So glad you're here today, and some of you are probably wondering, well, why do you have this wall up here this weekend? And actually, I want to build my entire message today around this wall. You know, we have a saying in the English language, when you're trapped, when you don't see any way out, we say, my back's against the wall, sure. It's those not fun times in life where you just feel trapped. I know many Eastsiders right now who would say their back's against a vocational wall. Downsizing, layoffs, quotas have put more work on a lot of people where now they're doing a job that four or five people used to do, and now they do it all by themselves, and it's just too much. Others are dealing with a lack of work, a lack of opportunity, a lack of a career right now. Some of you are dealing with business forces that are unpredictable. A marketplace where you're under enormous pressure. And just a lot of people, vocationally speaking these days, would say that their back's against the wall. I know a lot of people who, relationally, their back's against the wall. I corresponded with a husband this week. 2.5 years ago, his wife started drinking heavily and medicating with prescription drugs in order to deal with the pain of childhood sexual abuse that she experienced both from men and women. And then in the last year, she began having an affair that she's been in and out of, start and stop. And she's still drinking heavily, and she's under antidepressants. And recently, she began cutting herself. And this past week, she said she wants a divorce. And he loves her, and he cares about her, but his back's against the wall. For some of you, relationally, it's aging parents who are coming to a stage in life that they need care, and you're trying to sort that out, or it's a son or daughter or grandchildren that are out of control, and you don't know what to do. Some of you, medically, your back is against the wall. What do you do when you've had the surgery and you've done all the treatments, and nothing seems to be working, and you're running out of options? Some of you wonder, because of health concerns, if this is going to be your last Christmas, or if this will be your last Christmas with mom or with dad. Back's against the wall. Some of you, educationally speaking, your back's against the wall. You haven't gotten accepted to the grad school, the college or university that you applied to. Some of you are seniors this year in high school, in college, and come next spring, you have no idea what's next, and your back's against the wall. Fact of the matter is, while I'm talking right now, some of you are saying, I know exactly why I'm in church today. Because, Gene, you didn't know it, but what you're describing right now is my life to a T. My back's against the wall. I'm in a jam. I'm trapped. I don't know how I'm going to get out of it. Today we come to a very familiar passage of Scripture in Exodus chapter 14, in the Old Testament of the Bible. It's so familiar, I don't even need to read long sections of it to you. You know the story. In fact, I put some of the key verses on your outline if you just want to pull that out today and follow along. You already know the scene. There's this body of water called the Red Sea. Let's just pretend that this wall is the Red Sea. And camped out at the edge of the Red Sea is Moses and around 2 million Israelites. And I'll represent the Israelites here today. And then coming after the Israelites in hot pursuit are the Egyptian army. So you get to be the Egyptian army coming after me. Now, before you get too excited about that, I know that sounds kind of fun, your ending's not going to be so great. I'll just let you know right now, okay? So this is the scene. And it's only been a few days since the 10 plagues and the death of the firstborn in their households, but the Egyptians are coming after and heading toward the Israelites in full force. And the Israelites hear the hoofbeats of the horses. They hear the roar of the chariots. They see the cloud of dust in the sky. And thus this wall and our message today. What are they going to do? They're at the edge of the Red Sea. Where is God when they're trapped? Where is God when your back's against the wall? Now, by the way, do you know why the Egyptians were coming after the Israelites? Here's the rationale. A little snippet from Exodus 14:5 says, "We have lost their services." The Egyptians had built their entire economic structure on the backs of the free slaves of the Israelites. And now they're in a panic, and they don't want their economy to tank. They don't want it to go into a recession. And I want you to just think about this, friends. Throughout history, when one group of people oppresses another group of people or enslaves another group of people, when you strip it all back and you look at what's underneath it, it's much deeper than racism. It comes down to sheer economics, to money. And so the Israelites, they start hearing the hoofbeats and see the cloud of dust, and they're against the wall, and they're trapped. What are they going to do? Follow along as I read from Exodus 14, beginning in verse 10. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified, and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us out to the desert to die? I mean, what have you done to us bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Now, the Israelites are quite understandably having a very human, natural response to having their backs against the wall right now. And I want you to write three key phrases down. First, they're scared. Secondly, they become sarcastic with their leader, Moses. And then third, they just start imagining all kinds of worst-case scenarios. You know, there have been a number of times in my life where my back's been against the wall in marriage and family, as a pastor. And I know what it is to go right through these three things. I know what it is to be afraid in situations, to be scared. I know what it is to get sarcastic and to say things like, "Well, do you know what that person is really like? And you wouldn't believe what they did." And I can get that victim mentality going. And before you know it, I start imagining worst case scenarios and how all this thing can start falling apart into many pieces. And like a merry-go-round, I can just keep turning that around and around in my mind. And while I've learned that that's understandable, I've also learned it's not very productive. What you need and what I need at that moment is for someone to say, "Hey, if you cave into fear and you cave into sarcasm and to worst case scenarios right now, where is that going to take you? Isn't there a better way? Isn't there a better plan than that?" Now let's talk about when you're scared. Our text says in verse 10 that the Israelites were terrified. They're afraid. Let me ask you, do you tend to make better or worse decisions when you're scared? When you're afraid? Yeah, worse. When you're terrified, when your back's against the wall, we tend to not make good decisions there. I came across something. This is from the U.S. government's Peace Corps manual for volunteers in the Amazon and Amazon jungle. And it's what to do if you're attacked by an anaconda snake. Anaconda snakes are 35 feet long and grow that big. They can eat a live animal up to 300 to 400 pounds. Imagine that. So here's the instructions. If you're attacked by an anaconda, don't run. The snake is faster than you are. Lie flat on the ground. Put your arms tight against your sides and your legs tight against one another. Tuck in your chin. The snake will come and begin to nudge and climb over your body. Do not panic. After the snake has examined you, it will begin to swallow you from the feet end, always the feet end. Permit the snake to swallow your feet and ankles. Do not panic. The snake will now begin to suck your legs into its body. You must lie perfectly still. This will take a long time. When the snake has reached your knees, slowly and with as little movement as possible, reach down, take your knife, and very gently slide it into the side of the snake's mouth between the edge of its mouth and your leg. Then suddenly rip upwards, severing its head. Last point, be sure to have your knife. Friends, it's natural when your back's against the wall to be afraid. But think about it. Sometimes you make your worst decisions when you're afraid. You can be running away from an anaconda snake when you should be still. How about being sarcastic? Just look at the sarcasm of the Israelites to Moses in verse 11. Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die, Moses? I mean, were they out of cemetery plots in Egypt, and so you brought us to the desert for find some cheaper plots? Now, that's a really counterproductive conversation going on right there in this moment when your back's against the wall, don't you, between leader and followers? And then they throw in this line, verse 12, didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? Moses, weren't we begging you to leave us in Egypt where we had such good careers and such promising futures? Friends, do you remember that? I don't remember that either, because that never happened. They were begging God. They were begging Moses to get them out of Egypt, but now they're being sarcastic. They're being reckless with their language, and they're playing the blame game. You know, I've learned many times over the years in marriage, in a friendship, in a family, in the workplace, in a church, as tempting as it is to get sarcastic when your back's against the wall, sarcasm doesn't help. Usually it complicates the situation. It makes matters worse. Some of you have had business partnerships over the year that all started out great with someone you were in business with, and then you got your backs against the wall in the business situation. And this person who you used to be their biggest cheerleader, you used to be their biggest fan, you went into this together, all of a sudden you get sarcastic with each other and you start blaming each other. Some of us have been at family get-togethers, you know, at Thanksgiving, at Christmas celebrations, where something gets said and someone responds and someone gets sarcastic and someone ends up getting up from the table and walking out and slamming the door. In 30 years of ministry, I've seen church situations where people get sarcastic with each other or they get sarcastic with church leaders. And I just want to say, how does that help the situation? How is that Christ-like? When your back's against the wall and you're scared and you get sarcastic, it just compounds the problem. Now let's talk about worst case scenarios for a moment, because some of you are professionals at this one. We've turned catastrophizing into an art form. The Israelites look at their situation and they think they got it all figured out. They can see where this is headed and it's not good. They are predicting a bad outcome and they say, it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. Friends, nobody has died in the desert. Nobody. Ever lay in bed at night when your back's against the wall and your mind gets very creative with worst-case scenarios and you think of 1,000 ways that this thing can go bad? Let me just ask you, does that really help? Does it? Jesus asked one time, he said, who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? Jesus is saying, it's just unproductive. It doesn't help solve our problems. You can use that worrying energy in a much more positive way. So the Israelites are out in the desert, their backs against the wall, they're scared, they're getting sarcastic with their leader Moses, they're imagining all these worst case scenarios that could happen, saying, we're all gonna die, we're all gonna die, we're all gonna die. And at that point, Moses steps up and he puts on a clinic in leadership and crisis management and he says, time out, everybody. Listen up. I want to give you a better plan. This is not helping. We need a better plan. And here's what he says. This is the plan in verse 13, the key verse today. Do not be afraid. stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. Do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. Moses says, friends, this is a better plan. And it's simple. He says, first, we're going to adopt a fear not mentality. Do not be afraid. Second, we're going to stand firm. That's the plan. And finally, we are going to expect God's help in this situation. That's the new plan. This is what we're going to do. And friends, can I just tell you from my own experience in life, this is a much better plan. This is a plan that will actually help you when your back's up against the wall. And think about it. This comes right out of Scripture. Fear not. Stand firm. Expect God's help in your life. Now let's talk a little bit about what it means to fear not, to not be afraid. Some of you wonder, is it even possible to fear not when your back's against the wall? Yes, I believe it is. I believe it's possible to tame those wild, irrational, fearful thoughts that come flooding into your mind. Need an example? Take a look at this picture on the screen. Does that ring any bells? Remember Captain Sully Sullenberger takes off from LaGuardia, gets into a flock of birds, loses all the engines on this U.S. Airways flight? What does he do in that moment? Does he get all fearful and panic and get on the intercom and say, this is horrible. I don't know what we're going to do, people. We're going down in the river. If you believe there's a God in heaven, start praying because you're going to see him very soon. No, this pilot who had trained for these situations thousands of times with thousands of commercial hours of flight time stays calm, radios the tower and says, we're going into the Hudson. 90 seconds before they land that plane in the Hudson, he says to the crew and the passengers three words, calmly, courageously, brace for impact. And 155 lives were spared that day because he didn't give in to fear. What does a heart surgeon do? What does a brain surgeon do when they get into surgery and something goes wrong? Do they freak out? No, they stay calm. They stay focused. We have mothers in this church of multiple preschoolers. Yeah. Think about Ian's wife, Julia. You know, she's got 2 2-year-olds and a 3-year-old. If anybody ought to be freaking out, it ought to be her. You know, Julia stays calm, doesn't freak out. You see, we can learn to tame the wild, irrational, fearful thoughts that flood into our minds at moments like this. The Apostle Paul said to a young leader named Timothy one time, he said, for God did not give us a spirit of timidity, a spirit of freaking out. That's not from God. He said, but God gave us a spirit power, of love, and of self-discipline. You can have the self-discipline to not freak out. You can develop the ability to be in a fear-not position when you normally would be in a freak-out position. Now, for me, this may not help everybody, but for me, I'll tell you something that's helped me over the years is I carry a leather-bound journal with me everywhere I go, and when I sense some of those fearful thoughts coming up in me, I just write it out. I write them out, and it helps dissipate those thoughts when I write them down. And I start writing some faith-filled thoughts over those situations, more rational thoughts, more self-disciplined thoughts. And friends, this is something many of you can do, is to control your fears. Many of you do this professionally, and you don't think you can do it personally. But from the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of self-discipline in you, you can fear not instead of freak out. You can. And then Moses says, stand firm. Stand firm. You know, before coming to Eastside, I spent 5 years on the staff at Willow Creek Community Church outside of Chicago. And I worked with some great people, and it was a great church. But I was miserable in my position. I just was. It was a wrong fit for me. You ever had a position that's a wrong fit for you, and it just wasn't an expression of God's gifts for me at all? And after a lot of prayer and counsel with friends and family about it, I genuinely felt God calling us to do something different. And Barbara was supportive of the decision, but I resigned not knowing where we were going. I don't recommend that, by the way. We put our house up for sale, and it sold, not knowing where we were going. And, you know, we sensed God was calling us. Maybe he's calling us into the desert for a bit, you know, to show us a new promised land. And I had faith that God was leading us. But honestly, I had painted our family into a corner back against the wall. And I had a few moments wondering, did I misread you, God, on this one? What if no new ministry opportunities ever come my way again? How am I going to support our family? Where are my kids going to go to school next year? And there was a side of me that was going right down the list. Fear, sarcasm, imagining worst-case scenarios. And then I vividly remember one weekend, shortly after making that decision, I was guest speaking at a church in Rockford, Illinois. And they sang a song at the close of their service that weekend. I had probably sang 100 other times in my life before, but I heard it in a fresh way that day. It's a Matt Redman song, "You Never Let Go." And I remember singing the words that day. I mean, those words, "I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. Glorious light beyond all compare. I can see an end to this sorrow, but until that day comes, you know, I'll choose to follow you. I will still praise you." And the chorus is, "Oh Lord, you never let go. In every high and every low, oh Lord, you never let go of me. You never let go." And I'm telling you, I sang that song that weekend, standing up, shoulders back, full voice, and made it a declaration of faith. There's a light at the end of this tunnel, and I will hold on. And now it's just so clear to me, 4 years later, what God's plan was, and I see how he led me to Eastside, and I see his plan for the future of this church and a future of multiplied impact together, but I couldn't see it at the time. At the time, I just had to stand firm. We're in an elders meeting Thursday night, and we're celebrating the fact that this year, in 2011 at Eastside, we've had 335 baptisms, by far more than any other year in the history of this church, and we're just thanking God for that. You know what was going on inside of me at that time? Inside of me, I was thinking, and I could have missed all this. I could have missed it. Still, whenever I'm someplace and we sing that song, whether it's here or somewhere else, it comes from a place of deep declaration in me. Oh no, you never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me, and I will stand firm in you. Some of you are in a jam right now. And the best advice I could give you today is stand firm. If you did nothing more right now than just be a man of God, be a woman of God right now, firm in your convictions, firm in your faith, firm in the fact that you have a God who will never let go of you, it would position you for God to do something really good in your life. Fear not, stand firm, and then lastly, expect God's help. When your back is against the wall, and when you really believe, what you really believe about God is revealed in that moment. Let me say that again. When your back is against the wall, what you really believe about God, theologically, your convictions are revealed at that moment. When the pressure is on, when you are out of options and you're backed up against the wall, you can do one of two things. You can either say, "I am so screwed right now. I got myself into this situation. God's not going to help me get out of this situation. I'm going to have to get out of this situation myself." Or you can back up against the wall and say, at least I know I have a God who loves me, a God who cares for me, a God who is with me, a God who will never let me go, a God who has a track record of helping his sons and daughters throughout history when their backs are against the wall, and there is a shot that he's going to do it for me. And so I am going to expect God to help me in this situation. Any of you watch this new television show this fall, The X Factor, with the ever-lovable Simon Cowell on it? I kind of like the show, actually. And my favorite singer on the show is a guy named Josh Krajicek, and kind of got a Joe Cocker voice. And but my second favorite singer on the show is a girl named Melanie Amaro. She's from Florida, and man, she's got some pipes when she sings. And the other night, she was singing a song on the show that just kind of made you want to jump out of your chair. And it was, "There Can Be Miracles When You Believe." There was a gospel choir behind her, and it brought back memories for me because that song, which became a big hit, was from the movie on the life of Moses, the Prince of Egypt, over a decade ago. And I told some of you a few weeks ago how I was a part of a group of 12, 15 Christian leaders that met with Jeffrey Katzenberg at DreamWorks Studio when they were making that movie. And we met a couple different times to look at different takes of the movie and to give them feedback because they didn't want to unknowingly offend Christian audiences with something they had done artistically. And so we were with Katzenberg for the first time, and we watched the first rough cut of the movie, and we hear that song for the first time, but the lyrics were different. The lyrics at that time were, "You can do miracles if you believe." Beautiful medley, but those were the lyrics. And afterwards, you know, when Katzenberg was asking for our feedback, we said, you know, that's not what quite like what Christians believe. We don't believe that we can do miracles. We believe God is the one who does miracles. He's the creator. We're the creation. We can't do miracles, only he can. So the next time we met, we looked at the next copy of the movie. They had changed the lyrics to what it is now. Instead of, "You can do miracles if you believe," the lyrics were, "There can be miracles if you believe." And friends, I just want you to know that's been my hope and prayer all throughout this series on Where Is God? That we would get out of the way so that God can work his miracles in our life. That's exactly what he did for the Israelites. They were trapped with their backs against the wall on the edge of the Red Sea. And I want you to notice, did you ever notice this in Scripture? God never tells them that he's going to part the sea. He never tells them what he's going to do. He just says, "Stand firm. Stand firm." Now, here's the tricky thing in this. God's word is very clear that God tends to wait for your declaration of faith before he supernaturally intervenes. All the Israelites, they're freaking out. They're getting sarcastic. They're imagining all the worst case scenarios. And then there's just one man. It could have been one woman, but in this case, there's one man, Moses, who stands up and says, "I'm going to take a different route. You can all believe what you want to about God, but I'm expecting God in faith to bring deliverance to us today." Verse 15. "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on.'" I like that. Tell the Israelites to quit talking about it, quit praying, quit being afraid, quit being sarcastic, quit whining, quit imagining worst case scenarios. Just move on and step toward the very thing that you fear in faith. Move on. And God does one of the most incredible miracles of all times at that moment. He creates a wind. According to Exodus chapter 15, verse 8, it's a blast of God's nostrils. And the winds drive the waters back. And we don't even know how it could happen. But all 2 million Israelites go through the very thing that they fear. And they end up on the other side of this wall, this Red Sea. God didn't take the Israelites around the Red Sea. He didn't build a bridge over the Red Sea. He didn't dig a tunnel under the Red Sea. God took them through the Red Sea. Imagine walking between those walls of water. and you get to the other side, what would you do? You would do what they did. They had a worship time. It's recorded in Exodus chapter 15, like they had never had before. And they're just saying, what an awesome God we have. And maybe they were singing like I was that day. Oh no, you never let go through the calm, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. And they are celebrating and worshiping and parting. And you know the story of how the Egyptian armies are racing toward them, and they race into the Red Sea, and they're coming to draw them back to Egypt so they can oppress them for greed and for money. And when they get into the middle of the Red Sea, Moses lowers his staff, and the waters fall, and the Egyptians drown. And there's a terrible judgment that falls on them. But on the Israelite side, people are going, can you believe God did this? Have you ever seen anything like this? God made a wall of water to get us out of a jam. Friends, what do you think it did for Moses' faith when he was the only guy saying, fear not, stand firm. Expect God's help today. Don't you think it made it a little easier for him the next time that he was in a jam and he had to trust God and his back was against the wall? What do you think it did for the faith of the Israelites? They had just experienced the Passover miracle from the 10th plague when, because of the blood over the doorpost of their homes, the death angel passed over and didn't take the life of their firstborn. And now they've experienced this miracle of the waters in the Red Sea parting. In a few days, they're going to experience the manna from heaven miracle. And then they're going to experience the water from a rock miracle. Why was God doing this? To build their faith, to depend on him, to trust in him. You know, once in a while around here, I hear like some people at Eastside talking about our future and our move to Anaheim and our construction project out there. And I've talked to some people, they get a little scared about it all. And some can even get a little sarcastic, and they start imagining worst-case scenarios, and what if the money doesn't come in, and what if the economy tanks further, and what if people won't make the move, and what if there's a scandal, and we find out Gene Apple's on steroids or something. And I just stand before you today, and I want to say to you, I don't get that. I don't get that. When God has nothing but a faithful track record with this church and with this project. 3 years ago, we prayed for a fresh wind, and God brought a hurricane in this church. And then we prayerfully established search criteria for new property, and we found a property in Anaheim that not only met the criteria, but exceeded it. And they were asking $38 million for the property, and our negotiation team prayed and worked with them and got it for $20 million. And the owners were represented by a Christian man who, a full 2 years before we were even looking for property, had the sense that God spoke to him one night when he was sleeping that there was to be a church on that property one day. And so immediately, 2 years before we were even looking, he started changing the use restrictions on the property so there could be a church there one day. And then, you know, something we didn't talk about publicly for a long time, the financiers of that, the true owners of that property, were a group of Muslims in Abu Dhabi. And he convinced these Muslims to sell that property to a Christian church in Orange County, California. We wondered, well, would the city of Anaheim approve a project and let a church be there? Because we'd worked with the city of Fullerton. Took a full 3 years to get a project approved for this campus in Fullerton. Yeah, it was one 20-minute meeting in Anaheim to get our approvals there. Amazing. And then we're like, well, who's going to buy this property in this economy? And Dongshin Presbyterian Church comes along with a $16.6 million offer for this property. We ask God to lead us to do our part. Eastsiders committed nearly $8 million to this project. And friends, I stand before you today and just say, I do not understand the scared, sarcastic, worst-case scenario crowd. That's just unproductive anytime your back's against the wall in any kind of situation. And I just want to say publicly, I am throwing myself in with Moses when I look at the future of this church, and I'm in the fear not, stand firm, believing God will help us. Greatest days of this church are still ahead of us, crowd. What crowd are you in? What crowd are you in? This is the mode we ought to be in this church. This is the mode we ought to be in our personal lives, in our private faith story. And tomorrow you're going to write a new chapter in your faith story. And I just wonder how many of you are going to choose to write your story with a fear-based pen. Why would you get all afraid and sarcastic and expending all kind of energy on worst-case scenarios? Is that working for you, really? Today, I call you to a better plan. I call you to Moses' plan. I call you to the fear not, stand firm, expect God's help plan. I call you to start writing your story with a faith-based pen. And when your back is against the wall tomorrow, you say, but I am not going to freak out anymore. God did not give me a spirit of timidity and freaking out, but a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. And I'm going to discipline myself with the strength of the Holy Spirit to put those fears in a box. And with God's help, I will stand firm because he will never let go of me. And I'm never going to let go of the God who will never let go of me. I serve and I love a God who did the Passover miracle, the part the Red Sea miracle, the water from a rock miracle, the manna from heaven miracle, the Christmas miracle, the Good Friday miracle, the Easter miracle. I serve a God who has pulled off water parting stuff for thousands of years throughout history. Why wouldn't I believe that he will part the waters for me? Friends, God knows you. God loves you. God cares for you. And so today, you know what he's probably waiting for? Your faith. He's probably waiting for you to declare your faith and say, I am going to expect God to part some waters for me. And when God sees that, so often it's that faith that spurs heaven into action. Do you remember how many times Jesus would say to a person that he had healed or touched or forgiven or fixed, and he would say, your faith has made you well. Your faith.